We break that bread together in the love of Christ and in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then we pray and we have an opportunity to give our means. It's a time of celebration of how good God has been. Though we come to this place sometimes broken, sometimes confused, sometimes even discouraged, we can leave because we have been in the presence of God Almighty. And I pray this day as I speak the word of God that you'll receive it the way it's intended through the love of Jesus Christ. For every time that the word of God goes forth, it will not return back void. And so today I hope you'll receive the word of God. We're going to be reading from the book of Genesis, and if you'll turn there with me to chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1 is at the very beginning of the Bible. Right? The first two verses. There we have this word. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And then chapter 2. Verse 7. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. May God bless the reading and the hearing, yes, even the doing of His divine word. This morning I'm going to be speaking about the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of life. The Spirit of God is sometimes neglected in our teaching and preaching. I'm happy to report that people are speaking more and not even feeling like they need to somehow hide from the doctrine of the Holy Spirit today. I'm going to be teaching up in Kannapolis a whole class on a college level of biblical theology. And I'll be spending some time in the Holy Spirit, of course, as that being part of the doctrines of Christ that we find in the Bible. And I've been studying on the Holy Spirit lately. And these four sermons I'm going to speak to you this week and then next week will be centered around the Holy Spirit. This one being the Spirit of life. Tonight will be the Spirit of power. And so we invite you to come back and hear that message as well. Now, I want to share these things because when we look at the Holy Spirit, we're not just talking about some inanimate spirit, some type of force in the cosmos, some kind of being that is abstract. We're talking about a very personal divinity. We're talking about part of the Godhead, the triune God, and even the Trinity. Dean came up to Kannapolis not too long ago, and he spoke to us about the Trinity. More than likely, he's spoken some here on that very doctrine. About three being one, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. A very orthodox teaching that was taught in the early churches, but had some kickback from some heretical groups in the 4th century. And around 325 or so, they had a Council of Nicaea where they formulated in a creedal fashion about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Of course, we've been baptizing people in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit ever since the beginning of the church. In 381 at the Council of Constantinople, we also had another formulation of the creed as well. Again, reaffirming the importance of one and three, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. You know, there were teachings in the early church where some people had a problem with this whole concept, and it is problematic because we kind of look at things through a mathematical equation, and we don't understand how we can look at three and get one. That's pretty difficult, but we're not talking about mathematical equations. We're talking about divine entity. And so in the Bible, we are taught about the Father, we're taught about the Son, and we're also taught about the Spirit. In fact, in the early chapters of the Bible, we find the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And here in chapter 1, we find that in the beginning, everything was void. Everything was chaos. And I think that's very important for us to realize that God created by His power, and though it was through His power, it was still chaotic in one sense. And here the Bible says that the Spirit of God hovered there. Now I want us to grasp, if we can, how the Spirit of God can hover over the face of the waters, anticipating, reflecting. They're about to do the will of the Father, about to accomplish something that will blow our minds. If we had an opportunity just to vision that in our head, just to even picture it, even in a vague way, it is very powerful even to think about that God would turn nothing into something. Now get that. Now, Latin term ex nihilo is the concept here that something came out of nothing. One of the things that the scientists have a problem with these days when they are naturalistic, what I mean by naturalistic, they try to prove things in a natural way rather than turning towards a divinity, okay? Instead of God, they try to see how something natural produced something. And they come up with all kinds of theories how that might come about. And most of them are far-flung and are interesting, but they, at the end of the day, are not satisfying. And one of the big problems they have is somehow getting something out of nothing. That doesn't just happen every day. And it's amazing how that it's only when we talk about cosmology that scientists all of a sudden start talking about something from nothing. I want you to picture that. Something from nothing. They just said somehow matter just popped into existence. Now, we don't think about when we're going down the road that all of a sudden a crane would just pop out in front of us. That's not a thought of mine. I don't think that maybe as I'm about to have dinner at night that somehow there'd be an elephant that would just pop in the middle of my kitchen. That's not really a thought because that's really not realistic. I wonder why scientists, the people that think in empirical ways, somehow would think that things just happen, just pop into existence. Not an elephant. Not a crane in the midst of the road. I'm talking about this big, great universe that we're talking about. I'm talking about this earth in all of its glory. How in the world could that happen? And here we find that the Spirit of God was in the beginning hovering over the waters. God was about to bring order out of chaos. You know, the very opposite of order is chaos. And what happens when sin entered into the world, God's order then started decaying into chaos. Have you ever wondered why things are so crazy in our world? Is spinning out of control? It's because of sin. It's because of the work of Satan himself. The world is going in the direction that God does not want it to go. In fact, the world itself, the creation, groans. If you read the 8th chapter of Romans, you have this sense that the Spirit, that the creation itself, as it experiences this event of order into chaos, groans. It anticipates that one day the sons of God will be revealed. And that the chaos will once again become order as God so designs it. And it says there, it is by the power and by the might of God's Spirit that that happens. In the second chapter of Genesis, we find that God, in the creation of mankind, took from the ground dust. We're all made of the same substance. dirt and water. And out of the dirt, out of the dust, God formed man, and he breathed into the nostril of that man. And the Bible says he became a living creature. Now, in the first chapter, where it talks about the Spirit of God and God speaking things into existence, the word ruach is used there for the Hebrew. Now, that's the word of the Lord, the Spirit of the God that goes forth. But you know, it's not just speaking. The Spirit of God and the Word of God is something that goes forth and also has the ability to complete and create that which it speaks. It's not just saying that the light is on, but it is speaking the light into existence and that it would shine in our midst. There's words, but there is power behind it. God is able to complete that which he ordains. God is sovereign. God is all-powerful. He is all-knowing. He is blessed from the very beginning. And when God took that man, he breathed into his nostrils. Again, this idea of the Spirit of God, the breath of God. I was speaking to someone not too long ago, and I was speaking about John chapter 3 that we'll look at later, but I was saying to him that here this idea of the wind of God in John chapter 3 and verse 8 is talking about the Spirit of God. He said, no, it's not. It's talking about the wind. I said, if you look at the original languages and what he's talking about here, he's talking about the Spirit of God. It blows, it does as it so wishes. God's Spirit is sovereign. And so God breathes in this man, and he becomes a living spirit. I want you to know today that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You know why God so loved the world? Because he is the creator. He is the originator of that world. And he is the shaper. He is the one that gives us life. We breathe the air that we do. We produce. We bring forth children by the power of God. It is by that same Spirit, not only were we created, but we also are sustained. We're able to live and have our being because of the mighty God that we so serve today. Now, Spirit of life is a powerful concept. And sometimes I'm afraid that people truncate or reduce the Holy Spirit down to some type of common denominator where they can grasp it. You see, when we're talking about God's Spirit, it is beyond our comprehension. Doesn't mean that we can't understand everything about it. It's like talking about the Son. Can you understand completely that Jesus was 100% man and 100% divine? Can you get that? You understand that? Can you understand the Spirit proceeding from the Father and the Son? You grasp that? We just can't understand at times the majesty of God. And I guess if I could understand God completely, he would not be very much of a God, would he? God is above and beyond anything that we can think or imagine. He is the Spirit of life. In fact, when God removes his Spirit, there's death. If you look at the book of Psalms and Psalm 52, where David is praying, he is reflecting, he's praying that God may not remove his Holy Spirit from him. He was concerned that because of his great sin, that God would have nothing to do with him. But you know, God is merciful. He's willing to forgive us of our sins. I'm so glad today that We have been sealed with God's Spirit. We have received God's Spirit, and He marks us as His children. There be no confusion on the day when God judges the living and the dead. Sometimes people are praying, will God really let me into His eternal kingdom? Will God save me? Let me tell you today, if you have His Holy Spirit, He knows who you are. You cannot hide from God. He won't make any mistakes because He knows exactly who you are. You are marked. You are sealed with God's divine Spirit. If you want a passage on that, you can read 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 through 22. But there are other passages that could help you in understanding that in a deeper sort of way. I want you to turn with me now to Psalm 104. Psalm 104, again, is a reflection upon the creation itself. There's several passages in Scripture that reflect on the creation. So when you think about, if you want to understand in a deeper way the doctrine of the creation, it's important to read Genesis chapter 1 and 2, but you need also maybe read some in Job 38 and read some here in the book of Psalm 104 and other places that talk about God creating man, God creating the world. Look at chapter 104, Psalm 104, in verse 1. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. Do you get that? God's majesty. God just stretches out the heavens like a tent. They knew about the nomadic life. They knew about tents. And here he is giving this idea of God creating and stretching out the heavens like a tent. He lays the beams of His chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds His chariots. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes His messengers winds, His ministers of flaming fire. He set the earth on its foundation so that it should never be moved. He covered it with a deep as with a garment. The water stood above the mountains. At your rebuke they fled. At the sound of your thunder they took to flight. The mountains rose. The valleys sank down to the place that you appointed for them. You set a boundary that they may not pass, so that they might not again cover the earth. Again, he is talking about the majesty and the power of God in creation. Look over at verse 24 now. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Here is the sea, great and wide, which teems with creatures innumerable, living things, both small and great. There go the ships and Leviathan, which you form to play in it. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away your breath, they die and return to their dust. And here we have this idea of God sustaining things. And it's amazing how we find here this picture of that the sea is teeming with all kinds of creatures. Ones that exist now and ones that are extinct now. But you see, even as you see on television, maybe a ship going and floating on the ocean, and how the whales jump in the sea. You can see all the types of fish. If you go deep into the ocean, all types of sea creatures, the sharks, and other times of creation there. And there everything is sustained by the power of the Spirit of God, by His breath. This past week, once again, we had all kinds of tragedies in our country. And as I was speaking earlier, that sin produces chaos and death. Some of the problems that we're having in inner cities and even on the streets of America is because of sin and because of chaos and because people have left God. And even the tragedy, when you think about the couple of celebrities this past week that took their lives. 55 years old was the lady and 61 was the gentleman. Really, that's young. And they had so much in life. And somehow, I don't have the statement of the man, but I can kind of generalize it to you. Something that he wrote in some piece some time ago, he basically said there's no such thing as God. There's no such thing as someone taking care of you or some idea like the providence of God. And he took his life. There was nothing really for him to live for, I guess. Not only was there chaos in his life, but there was chaos in his soul. Not understanding that God not only loves the world, but God actually loved him. And he wanted a personal relationship with them. And so it was with the lady who was big in the fashion, big in the celebrity world. There she found no reason to live. And so she took her life. You know, God brings life. When the Spirit of God is in the person, in the life of a person, just like as if it's in the sea, when the Spirit of God is within us, it brings unto us life. It brings hope. It brings perseverance. And it pours out into our heart the love of God. Know in the book of Romans chapter 5 that there Paul says that God pours out love into our hearts by His Holy Spirit. That's a wonderful passage. Romans 5 and verse 5. God wants to help us to understand not only does He sustain us and bless us and keep this world together, He also gives us a meaning and purpose in life. He wants to always tell us how much He cares and how much He loves us. Psychologists tell us, especially one I read many years ago, Eric Fromm, book called Art of Love. He said basically, he's a psychiatrist, he said basically if you look at all the maladies, psychological maladies in people's life at the very core, he's not saying that people can't have imbalances in their chemicals and so, but when you talk about problems in people's lives, he said at its very core, there's a lack of love. And I've taken that away from that book I read many years ago. Think about this. Think about in people's lives, in your own life, how the dysfunction happened in your life. And all of us deal with dysfunction from time to time. And as we look back at that, we start realizing that it's very core. Where someone was not showing love, someone not feeling love, someone not understanding love, a rejection of love in some way. People at times don't know how to give love because they've never received it in a healthy way. Here we learn from the book of Romans, and even from this passage, God sustains us and God pours out into our hearts His love. And that's more than just saying a few words. For if you look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, it says that God is love. God gives love. God wants to pour out into our hearts His love. Love itself brings vitality, perseverance, and power to our lives. You want to rejuvenate your relationship with your spouse? Love one another.
If you want to rejuvenate a church that's struggling, learn to love one another as Christ first loved you. How do you become evangelistic in the church? Love the world, those who are lost, the way that Christ first loved you, and how the Holy Spirit has poured out love into your life. When you do that, God feeds into your heart, into your life, His life eternal. Now to the book of John, chapter 3. John chapter 3, where we'll end up today. John chapter 3, but I'm going to read John chapter 6. John chapter 3, verses 5 to 8. And John chapter 6. Starting at verse 62, John 6, 62. Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? Verse 63. It is the Spirit who gives life. I want you to focus on that. It is the Spirit, it is God's Holy Spirit that gives life. Now, Adam, when he was formed, out of the dust of the ground, God breathed in him and he became a living spirit. God created the creatures of the sea, and God, when he withdrew that spirit from them, that they perished, they died. And here, the Bible teaches us that it is the Spirit of God who gives life. And we're talking about eternal life. We're talking about our spiritual life that we find in Jesus Christ. The flesh is no help at all. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew the beginning, from the beginning, who those were who did not believe, and who it was who betrayed him. And so Jesus knew who would betray him, those who did not believe in him. You know, the Spirit gives life. In the third chapter of John, Nicodemus came to Jesus by night. And we all know the story of Nicodemus. He was a part of the Sanhedrin. He was very, very important person there in Jerusalem, but he came to Jesus by night, probably because he didn't want anybody to see him associating with Jesus. But he was one of Jesus' secret disciples that cared for Jesus. He came to Jesus by night. Then he says to Jesus in verse 3, he says this, Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, the Jews wanted to see the kingdom of God. The prophets had foretold there was a day in which Israel would be restored to its rightful position. They had been occupied for years. They had the Medes and the Babylonians, they had the Medes and the Persians, they had the Greeks, now they had the Romans. But there was going to be a time in which they would be restored to their glory, and David once again would sit on the throne there in Jerusalem. And of course, in a figurative way, if you read Luke chapter 1 and verse 32, there it tells us that Jesus would sit on the throne of his father, David. He would be the king that was foretold. But here Nicodemus wanted to know about the kingdom. And here Jesus tells him, you must be born again or you cannot see
that kingdom. That was enough to confuse anyone. How in the world can I be born again, being full grown? How can I go and enter into my mother's womb again and be born? That's even silly to think about, but nevertheless, Nicodemus spoke that, questioning, querying Jesus, how could this be true of me? In verse 5, Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Jesus said, if you want to be a part of the new kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, you need to be born again. But it's not a conventional birth as we would speak of physical birth today. It is a spiritual birth, and you must be born of the water and the Spirit. Ever since the beginning of the church, people have interpreted this in different ways, but the main interpretation that has come through the years, and you can read back in the church fathers, is this. He's speaking of one baptism with two elements here. And so it's not a contradiction of what Paul says, that there's one baptism in Ephesians chapter 1, and chapter 4, excuse me. Jesus is saying that we're born again, we're baptized in the water and the Spirit. And so we receive God's Spirit when we are renewed in our relationship with God. You might say, well, I don't quite understand that. In Acts chapter 2, maybe you understand that. Because he's basically saying the same thing. He's saying there, Peter, when he was preaching on the day of Pentecost, they said, what shall we do, brothers? How shall we deal with our guilt and our sin? And Peter said, this is how you do it. He said, repent. Now, that's not a strange comment for a Jewish preacher to be preaching. Because that's exactly what John the Baptist had been preaching. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And so Peter also says, turn back to God. You have strayed into chaos. You have strayed away from God. And be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. Now listen. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so Peter was basically telling them exactly what John the Baptist had been telling the people. Repent. To return back to God. If you want God to dwell in your midst, if you want him to sit upon the throne of David and you follow him all the days of your life, repent and be baptized. We know what baptism is. It is immersion. It's a symbolic act of dying to self as one gives their heart unto God and being raised out of that watery grave to walk in a new person in Jesus Christ, having received the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now remember what I said in John chapter 6, in verse 63, that the Spirit is the Spirit of life. He is the creative Spirit. He is the one that pours out into our lives a breath from God. He is the one that pours out into our hearts the love of God. And he is the one that recreates us in the image of God. We have fallen. We have been in our sins. We have rejected God. We have marched straight into chaos. And God said, we're going to do a do-over here. You received life, and now you're dead in your sins and your trespasses. But I'm going to give you another life, an eternal life, one that will rejuvenate you and give you hope once again and let you live and abide with me forever. There he says, I will give you my Holy Spirit.
you'll be born again, not by the will of the flesh, but by the Spirit of God. And so this morning, you've received the first lesson on the Holy Spirit, of the power of God in recreating us. He did a pretty good job in creating this whole world. Let me tell you this, God can also do a very good job in your life as well. He can come, whatever you made a mess of in your life, He can come and make it whole again. You've sinned and done some evil in your life, join the club. Everyone that's sitting here, and yes, even standing here, have lived a life of sin, but if we've accepted the Lord into our life, and the Spirit of God has come to make His home in our life, that He will make it right again. How in the world can we be considered ones that are close to God and children of God? Because we have been made anew, washed by the blood of the Lamb, sanctified and sealed by God's Spirit. I want to ask you, are you there this morning? Are you right with God? You know, when the Word of God is preached, as I did this morning, I pray that God uses that Word in touching your hearts. If you're being convicted today, it's not just my words. It is God's Spirit that is convicting you. It is God trying to say something to you. He is trying to open your heart that you might receive His great mercy and forgiveness. Sometimes people wonder about the prodigal son. How in the world could he ever do that? How could he go and basically say to his father, I don't care if you die. I'm just going to do my own thing. And he went off and lived a life in the world and lived among worldly people and got to the point that he lived and ate among pigs. And he said, my father's house, the slaves are treated better than I am, so I think I'll go and ask my father that I might serve him. He messed up his life. But we have a wonderful picture of God. The Father who was waiting there on the porch. There waiting, looking far out, waiting for the Son's return. And that one day when he saw his Son at a distance. You know, the Bible doesn't say that he continued and thought about it. He didn't do this number on anything, just thinking. He just leaped and fell upon his son with kisses, brought forth a robe, and called for a fatted calf. My son who once was lost is now found. And that's what God wants for you today. Whatever you've done in your life, whatever you have become, God is still waiting. Come, for in His Word has gone forth. Receive it as the grafted Word of God, that it might bring forth life, eternal life, forever.